हाँ
ആ
ആ
ഈ മറ്റേ നമ്മുടെ ഇന്നത്തെ സ്പീക്കറിൻ്റെ അത് ഏതാ വരുന്നത്? അനൂപ്. ഓക്കെ ഓക്കെ
അനൂപ് സാറ് കയറിയിട്ടുണ്ട്.
ഗുഡ് ഈവനിങ് എവരിബഡി.
ഗുഡ് ഈവനിങ് സാർ. അച്ഛൻ നൗ 50 ഞാൻ വിടുവാണ് ലൈവ്. മറ്റേ ജയമ്മമ്മിൻ്റെ
അപ്പൊ 10 മിനിറ്റ്സ് ഉണ്ടത് നമുക്ക് അല്ലേ? 550 50
ലൈവ് പോയെ. ജോസർ ഷുസാറ ഇത് ചെയ്തേക്കണേ, കോഹോസ്റ്റ്, ഐ മീൻ സ്പോട്ട്ലൈറ്റ് ചെയ്തേക്കണേ. ഞാൻ അഡ്മിറ്റ് ചെയ്തോട്ടെ അച്ഛാ.
ഹലോ, ഗുഡ് ഈവനിങ് ഡോക്ടർ അനൂപ്. റെഡി നോ? ഓക്കെ.
അനൂപ് സാറിന്റെ അവിടുത്തെ ലൈറ്റിംഗ്
പുറകിലെ ഒരു വിൻഡോ തുറന്നാണെന്ന് തോന്നുന്നു അല്ലേ?
ലൈറ്റ് വരുന്നത്. ലെറ്റ് മീ സീ ഹൗ കൻ ഐ അറേഞ്ച്. ലെറ്റ്സ് ഹാവ് ടു കം ക്ലോസർ.
മുഖത്തോട്ട് വെട്ടം കുറവ്.
ഇച്ചിരി എക്കോ വരുന്നുണ്ടോ സാറിന്റെ അവിടെ നിന്ന്?
അച്ഛൻ ലൈവ് വിടുവാണേ.
ഓക്കെ
ബൈ.
സജു അറ്റൻഡൻസ് നോക്കിയോണേ.
സജു ആണോ അതിന്റെ റെക്കോർഡൊക്കെ വെക്കുന്നത്?
അതെ അതെ.
It's better now, I know.
പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കാം. ഞങ്ങളുടെ ദൈവമേ, പരിശുദ്ധനായ കർത്താവേ, അനുഗ്രഹിക്കപ്പെട്ട നല്ല നിമിഷങ്ങൾക്കായിട്ട് സ്തോത്രം. ദൈവകൃപയുടെ ഈ ദിവസം ഞങ്ങൾ അനുഭവിച്ച എല്ലാ കരുണകൾക്കും അനുഗ്രഹങ്ങൾക്കും ദൈവികമായ സുരക്ഷിതത്വത്തിനായിട്ടും സ്തോത്രം. സന്ധ്യയോട് അടുക്കുമ്പോൾ ഞങ്ങൾക്ക് ഒരുമിച്ച് കഥാവെ ഈ പഠന സെമിനാറിലായിത്തീരുവാൻ ദൈവ സഹായിക്കുന്ന എല്ലാ മുഖാന്തരങ്ങൾക്കായിട്ടും സ്തോത്രം ചെയ്യുന്നു. തിരുസഭയ്ക്കായി, ഞങ്ങളുടെ ഭദ്രാസനത്തിനായി, ജയമം സ്റ്റഡി സെന്ററിനായിട്ട് സ്തോത്രം ചെയ്യുന്നു. ഞങ്ങളുടെ സ്റ്റഡി സെന്ററിന്റെ നേതൃത്വം നൽകുന്ന എല്ലാ പഠന സമ്മേളനങ്ങൾക്കായിട്ടും കാലികമായ ഇടപെടലുകൾക്കായിട്ടും പ്രവർത്തനങ്ങൾക്കായിട്ടും സ്തുതിക്കുന്നു. കഥാവെ, ഇന്ന് നടക്കുന്ന പഠന സമ്മേളനം ഏറ്റവും അനുഗ്രഹമായി തീരുവാൻ, പുതിയ ദർശനങ്ങൾ സ്വീകരിക്കുവാൻ കഥാവെ, പൊതുസമൂഹത്തിന് ദൈവരാജ്യത്തിന് മഹത്വത്തിന് വേണ്ടി എല്ലാവരും ഉപയോഗിക്കപ്പെടുന്നതിന് മുഖാന്തരമായി തീരുവാൻ ദൈവം നമ്മരാൻ സഹായിക്കണമെന്ന് പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്നു. കഥാവെ, ലക്ഷ്യത്തിന് നേതൃത്വം നൽകുന്ന എല്ലാവരെയും ദൈവം ഇക്കൂടി വരവ് സന്തോഷത്തിന്, ഒരുമയ്ക്ക്, ദൈവത്തിന്റെ നാമ മഹത്വത്തിന് മുഖാന്തരമാകണം. യേശുവിന്റെ നാമത്തിൽ യാചിക്കുന്നു. കൃപയോടെ കേൾക്കുമാറാകണമേ. ആമേൻ.
Good evening to one and all present here. I am Ishana Anjovan, a student of Lekkur Champaka Serene Valley Kalayam, Thiruvananthapuram. It is indeed with a special privilege and pleasure I welcome you all to the third lecture of the series organized by JMM Study Center, Thiruvananthapuram. I feel immense pleasure in introducing our honorable chief guest, Dr. Anoop Kumar Tekkuvittil, an accomplished personality in the field of biomedical science. Today, he will be guiding us through the topic of exciting possibilities in molecular genetics and genomics. Dr. Anoop Kumar Tekkuvittil is a senior scientist at Sri Sitra Thirunal Institute for Molecular Sciences and Technology, heading the Division of Molecular Medicine. He secured his MSc in Molecular Biology from Cochin University. Then he did his PhD at Bose Institute, Kolkata, and postdoctoral research at Columbia University, New York. He was a fellow of Harvard University, USA during 2004 to 2005. His current research is on molecular pathways involved in learning and memory using neuron-specific mutations that affect the cellular circuits. His group also focuses on developing molecular diagnostics for tuberculosis and human papilloma virus. Recently, his group has contributed to the diagnosis of COVID-19. They developed an innovative multiplex RT-PCR kit and magnetic nanoparticle-based RNA isolation kit. Both these products are being commercialized. Dr. Anoop has guided PhD, MPhil, and postgraduate students. He has many national and international publications and patents to his credit. I feel extremely honored to welcome you, sir. We hope for an exciting journey with you. I hereby welcome Reverend Linwin C. Thomas, who blessed us with the showers of prayers. I also welcome Reverend Manoj Irikila, who is offering the closing prayers. It is my pleasure to welcome Associate Director of JMM Study Center, Reverend Dr. K. Jameson, and convener of its current awareness forum, Dr. K. N. Nainan, sir. Their hard work and dedication have brought this program to life. I am delighted to welcome Dr. Deepti Shivadas, scientist BSSE, who is effectively coordinating our Q&A session. I am greatly pleased to welcome the technical and media team who are ensuring seamless Zoom meeting and YouTube streaming. I bid a very warm welcome to the teachers, parents, and well-wishers from far and near who took their valuable time and joined us today to be a part of this lecture series. Finally, I welcome all the students who are eagerly waiting for this exciting session. Your enthusiasm and cooperation have given this program a meaningful purpose. Once again, a very warm welcome to you all. Thank you.
Shall I start or?
Please, sir.
Yes, sir, please.
Let me try to share my slides.
Yeah, probably.
You can see it, right? You can see the slides?
Yeah, it's visible. Yes, full screen. Okay.
Thank you very much for inviting me, Professor Nainan and Fathers. It was a great, indeed a great privilege for me to talk to a varied group. You know, this may be my first time at different age group of people sitting together. And we are discussing about, these extremely tough topics of genetics and genomics. But I think this is the right time to talk about genomics and genetics because we are going through a pandemic. And many of you are very familiar with a lot of terms like, PCR, which has been done very commonly nowadays for diagnosis, which we were not aware of it a year back. Plus, we are hearing about, we are also hearing about the variations in the virus, they are becoming more. So I'll take you a small journey through this and tell you how this all happens in biology, how the systems actually changes through it, and how it evolves. That's what I want to talk about it. My voice is not audible. You can't hear me?
Yes, sir. No, okay.
Now it's okay?
Yeah.
So I will take you to some of my work, which is, I just want to just brush it through. So you know where I stand and what is my, expertise in this field. Basically, as it was well introduced about me, my lab is really interested about how our brain actually functions. And we use a lot of genomic research towards to understand that. if you look at our body, brain is the only organ we have least understanding about. You know, we don't know how we remember things, how we learn, how we store information inside the brain, and how we recall as memory. It's very complex process and we have no idea about it. We also forget, you know, it's not like a computer. So once it is stored, you know, it will be permanently stored. It is not like that. It is happening. So it's very complex process and we have very least understanding of it. You know, if you look at the brain is made of cells, right? And cells do store information because all our body is made of cells and all the cells have some information because skin knows what it is supposed to do. A liver knows what it is supposed to do and heart knows what it is supposed to do. Brain also knows what it is supposed to do, but all other organs, for example, doesn't talk you back and doesn't tell you what is it is stored inside, you know, but brain actually tells you. So that is a very surprising thing. How is it telling you back, you know, what information is actually stored? The question is that how it is storing, in what form it is storing inside. So that's what we try to understand. Because all the animals has the same way of learning, if you look at it, just like we learn. All animals learn exactly, almost similar. The basic learning pathways are very same. We use this worm. It's a worm, okay? It's a small worm, 1 millimeter in size. And we use this animal to understand how it is learning because it has only 300 neurons, 305 neurons to be exact. And it is transparent. So you can see the brain from outside. You can just look through the microscope and you can see the brain. So it is very easy to study. And its whole genome has been sequenced. It's, you know, connect all the neuronal connectome has been mapped and all. It's one of the most well-worked model system in biology. Already got around five to six Nobel Prizes. People worked on this model system. So we use this model to understand how it is learning. We can teach this one, that's why. You might have heard this dog experiment. When a dog is, you know, showed the food, then it will salivate, right? It is feel like, you know, I'm hungry. And if you ring a bell, it doesn't salivate. But if you show the food and the bell together, it started associating between these two signals. And next time when you just ring the bell, it is anticipating the food is going to come. So this is called as conditional learning. We call it conditional learning. So you give a conditional stimulus by which brain understand that something is going to come. The food is, if it is associated with food, it understand food is coming. And if it is a fearful condition where some teacher is coming to the class, you know the teacher is going to beat you up or going to scold you if you didn't do the homework properly. And you will be have that scare feeling, right? This is called as conditional. We all have that. We all are conditional to different atmospheric things, environmental conditions. So this conditional learning is a very powerful learning. Okay. So the worm also do the same kind of learning. Now, if you give food and a smell associated with it, you know, so it started understanding whenever I hear get this smell, there will be food available.
Anup sir?
Yes.
Anup sir, please click the slideshow mode.
You want
it's a PPT down. Slideshow mode, PPT, slideshow mode.
Yeah.
Downward, yeah. Please come downward.
No,
yeah.
Is it the screen there you are seeing?
Yeah, I will see, but it's in a slideshow mode. Please come downward, please. Yeah. Yeah, that slideshow mode clip.
Yeah, I was in the slideshow mode. Now is it okay?
No, sir. I'll just click.
Yeah, I clicked on the slideshow mode.
Okay.
Do you have two screens?
No.
We are seeing only the slide preparations.
Really?
Yes. Yeah.
Just a minute. What is the problem? Can you see the slides now? How is it showing?
Yeah.
Previous two slides we did not hear. See.
Did you see the previous slides? These slides?
And two
second
and three.
And third. Second and third.
This one you have seen, right? The worm picture?
No, not seen.
You have not seen this.
Earlier one also.
That was just
yeah. Yeah, yeah, that one. Yeah.
And let me go with this slide then. Then it'll be easier. I think something is wrong with the full mode. Is it okay? You can all see that, right? Can read
yeah,
it?
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, okay.
Go with this. So this is the experiment I was talking about. In a worms, because I told you the worms are very small, I can grow them in a petri plate, you know, small petri plates. And you can condition them by a smell and the food, and if they started moving around. And so we ask the same question, how does it learn? How does it understand this? This learning is very powerful for the worm. It can keep this memory. If you are training for 1 hour, it will keep this memory for around, you know, almost a day. Okay, and if you train multiple times, it goes up to 3 days or 4 days. The whole life of the worm is only 21 days. So it is, we are talking about almost 10 to 15 years of memory, what we keep in our brain. Because this worm has its neurons and are all extremely mapped, you're actually seeing the worm through microscope. You can actually see the inside of it. You're actually observing inside. And all this, the lights which is coming out are actually labeled neurons. So you can see that which neuron is actually activating this information when it is recalling this info. So it can be easily studied. So that is a big advantage of it. And you can also see that which are the neurons actually dying in the brain. So we create Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's disease in this worm and see that, you know, whether the neuron is dying or not, I can see from outside. Just looking at the microscope through the worm. So then we can study that what are the complexities happening in the animal, what kind of features, how the neurons now communicate once one neuron is missing. All those studies are possible. So that is advantage of it, you know, because we can do this kind of experiment because of its genome is well known. So we know which gene we are actually mutating, which gene we should touch it and all. So that's the introduction part of it. So we do a lot of work on that. Mainly because, as I told, you know, its genome is well mapped and the connectome. So let's just repeat this. Yeah. So let us come to the actual topic of the today's discussion. It's about genetics and genomics. So these are two words. We should understand what is these words stands for. Genetics is a very old concept, and which was where the whole program has started. Genetics is basically, it's a study of hereditary, you know, how you acquire some information from your parents. So it's through genes. Okay, so when you study only a single gene at a time, it is called as a genetics study. You know, you can create one mutation and understand what is happening into the. So this was our last, you know, maybe 15 years back, we were doing all this kind of works, you know, single gene at a time, understanding how it is functioning and it was. Once a lot of genome, the whole chromosome started getting sequenced, you know, we know how many genes we have now and how the genes are organized together. All those information came there. So a lot of new insights came. That is where the genomics as a field has come, because it is now we are studying how these genes are actually cross-talking each other and how these genes are organized in an organism. Once this organization changes, what kind of variations it is creating inside. So that's a much more complex study now, because we have you know, techniques to study this now, because the biology has grown so well. We have newer and newer technologies every day coming, and we can study all these complex interactions now in biological systems. You might have studied this, you know, in a chromosome is where the genes are existing, and DNA, basically it's mainly made of DNA. And the DNA has four bases, adenine, guanine, cytosine, thymine. We call it as alphabets, okay? It's these alphabets are arranged in a series like that, non-stop series. Huge genomes, sometimes if it is take human, there is a 23 pairs of chromosome. And this chromosome number changes between animals. Each model systems, you know, each animal has a specific number of chromosomes. If you look at human, we have 23 pairs of chromosomes. You can see these chromosomes are of different sizes. Okay, so chromosome number one chromosome is the biggest one among us. And the smallest are 21 and 22, very almost like a dot. And we have a sex chromosome, X. If it is a male, it is an XY male, and female will be XX. So we have 23 pairs of chromosomes. And this is how the DNA is actually arranged. It's a, you all know, it's a double-stranded molecule. And it is arranged in such a very specific way that because if there are two strands, the both strands has to be, you know, chemically bonded together. So this bonding is done through a very specific base pairing. We call it base pairing. Always adenine will be bound with thymine and guanine with cytosine. If it is cytosine here, it will be guanine this side. So there is a predictability. That's what it is happening. And if you know one strand sequence, you can almost guess what is a sequence in the other strand because it will be complementary to each other. That's a big jump in biology, which is considered as one of the landmark discoveries in biology. Because earlier biology was considered as an unpredictable subject. We don't know why it happens, why we grow, why we look like a human, why a dog look like a dog. Okay, we have no ideas about it. Now we know there are a lot of predictabilities there because our genetic code is extremely predictable in nature. We can predict what are the changes. If there is a small changes happens in the DNA, that will reflect upon our character, our physique, everything it will reflect because it is our code. This is how we are made of, and whole our life is depends upon this small alphabets we are looking at here. So that is very strange, and it's very powerful discoveries in the world. One of the biggest powerful discoveries. And if you look at it, I told you the DNA is a four, alphabets are only four, just like in English alphabets, DNA is made of only four bases. Now, DNA is actually transferred into an RNA and to a protein. Finally, a functional molecule is a protein. And there are 20 amino acids only present. All the proteins are made of 20 amino acids. And another alphabet, we are talking about a translation of a DNA into a protein, which is going to be the functional thing, and which is made of 20 alphabets. Okay, now the question is that how these four bases create this 20 alphabet out of it? It has to translate into protein. So that has been decoded. This is, we are talking almost like a, understanding an unknown language and you are trying to learn, figure it out. What is it actually telling? You have a long alphabet, we have no idea where it is actually sitting. So the DNA is actually coding in triplets, three bases, one alphabet. Okay, one amino acid will be coded by three bases. It could be adenine, AAA, TTT, whatever it is, three different combinations. This has been decoded. So we are talking about all these works are actually, this decoding was done by an Indian, Hargobind Khurana, who got a Nobel Prize for doing this work. So great discoveries, we know where the alphabets are, and we can also see some alphabets which three triplets comes, it becomes a stop. And all the proteins in mammals will start with this AUG, there is a methionine. The first amino acid in all the proteins are methionine, not in prokaryotes, I'm talking about eukaryotes. Prokaryotes are slightly different. But so we know which is a starting alphabet, just like in a language when you start a sentence, you'll write the something, right? So something of that, this is a starting point of a sentence. So something like that, it is coding. So the is the, and there is a full stop. So a sentence is finished. Okay, that is the gene. Whenever a language is there and there is a starting point and an end point is there, we call that sequence as a gene. So chromosome can be big, but there is only few meaningful sentences in the genome. So those meaningful sentences are the genes in the chromosomes. How do we understand this codes is by a machine available. You can sequence this. So if you take the blood sample, because all our body, all the cells have the same chromosomes, okay. So any body is a cell sample, we can take it out and give it to the machine. Machine will sequence and tell that this is the sequence at which it is present. So from there, you can figure it out, wherever the mutations are, is it a human gene or is it a cat? You might have heard that, somebody, a forensic analysis, somebody's hair can be taken and isolate the DNA and sequence and find out who was that person. So it's so powerful as the technique nowadays. Sequencing has given us a lot of chances for that. we also know that it is the chromosome is not a continuous language. You know, if you look at the DNA, you can see that it is written as exon, and these blues are introns. Okay, so finally the exons are the one which is finally has to put together to have a meaningful sentence. It's like a, you know, words selected from different region, put it together into a final RNA, and then only a protein will start. Now the question is that why it has broken this into small pieces. This breaking has come mainly because we got lot of viral infection before, and we were evolving. Lot of virus was infecting us, and all this viral genome has been incorporated into our chromosome. That's how our chromosome become bigger and bigger and bigger. And we also evolved a technique at which we know how to remove this when we actually produce proteins. So then the question, why did we allow this to come in? Why we should have protested against the virus, and we should not allow this DNA to sit into our chromosome at all, right? But in the evolution, it got us, give us a lot of advantage, because somebody is offering you a DNA. And once you have a new DNA comes into your gene, in your system, you can create a new gene. It may have a new word, can be created. So that's how we evolved faster. All the evolutions are happened mainly because these viral infections and all this chromosome is getting mixed up with other genes and together. That made evolution much faster. That's why this lot of species happen. Even human looks 3 or 4 different kind of Chinese person versus an African person versus a Caucasian versus an Asian. Different mainly because of we have these small variations, the genes were these different infections we got it. Our genomes are a little bit shuffled here and there and all. It will reflect in our way we look like. Okay. So this gives an advantage. That's what biggest thing. So it was a game. Both of us were playing. A virus wanted a host. We thought that, okay, if I give you a space, I need some advantage behind. Okay. So that was given to us. So that was the play between two living organisms, each other. Virus is another living organism, and human as a separate living organism. All the species do the same thing. Okay. So there is a game plan. We know how to remove it. So let us keep it. Whenever not needed, we will remove it. But if you have an advantage, I will use it as an exon. So suddenly this can become an exon and use it as a new protein. I can create a new protein all of a sudden, which may give me an advantage sometimes. Okay. So that is the play. That's the game. We don't know exact the whole choreography of that drama, but we know some guessing, you know, this is how it is happening. Now, we know a human has evolved from all these species, the orangutan, gorilla, and chimp and all, okay. How did, this is a gorilla, and from her, in a human difference is very, very less in the genes, very less, but you look at them, each other, I mean, they're very different, right? How come that happened? Okay, that's a very surprising thing happened in biology. That is a very surprising discovery. If you look at the chromosomes, the first line, this is the one chromosome, and this chromosome is a human chromosome. The second one is a chimpanzee's chromosome. The third one is gorilla, and the fourth one is orangutan. So the chromosome number one looks exactly the same. If you look at chromosome number two, actually, the chimpanzee, gorilla, and orangutan had a two chromosomes. It's actually a broken two pieces. When we become human, what we did was we fused these two pieces into one and made a chromosome number two. A surprise happened in biology. And we changed. We changed from chimpanzee to human all of a sudden, just by fusing two pieces of DNA into one. Okay, that is a, you know, I'm showing all these landmark results in biology. You know, this is a very surprising result. It was in, you know, flashed in the TV and news and everywhere, because it's so surprising to see. How did it happen? We don't know. But it happened and changed everything. You know, a human was created out of it. And it's so dramatic if you look at it. Now, none of them had this fusion. None of them had. But all other chromosomes looks, I mean, there are a lot of gene differences, some, But this is the dramatic change happened. Now you know whole human genome has been sequenced now. We know the how our genome looks like. So that is where the genomics, actually human genomics has started. Once the human genome was sequenced in 2000, and that papers came, and then it's a revolutionary, you know, we know how it looks like. Actually, we thought when we in the human genome program started, there was a bet, how many genes human can have. So there was a guess that there will be, should be around 1 lakh genes, because we are the highest, you know, we are the best in the world. So we should have the highest number of genes also. That was the guess. And when it was sequenced, I told you, you know, we can find out where the gene is. You have a starting point and a stop codon is also there. So you know how many sentences are actually there in the, meaningful sentences are there in the chromosomes. You know, you can, the software will predict automatically. We have only 20,000 genes. There are animals, especially in marine animals, which have 40,000 genes. So we are not even close to that. So that was a big surprise. Then how we become so intelligent, you know, how we, our brain has become so intelligent, and we can figure out what is going to happen in future, like consciousness we have in our brain. We can figure out from another person suffering, we can figure out how to solve the issues and all. So those are surprising evolution we have developed, and it doesn't look like the number of genes has anything to do with it. So that's where the genomics came. It should be the interaction of the genes, how the two genes are interacting each other. So the journey towards the human, I'm sorry, this slide become very small, crowded, because we went through a lot of sequencing before we finally reached on 2002, this human genome was sequenced. We were sequencing the E. coli, we were sequencing the C. elegans that's sitting here, my worm. It was sequenced in 1998. Then we have this mouse genome, this mouse genome is here. So all those helped us to understand how to sequence the genome, because human genome is quite big. We have 23 pairs of chromosomes, and so huge in number. It was a big effort. It took 10 years to complete. Now you look at it, you know, now we know, for example, this is a colorectal cancer. Okay, colorectal cancer, we are talking about, there are 25 genes were selected and looked at them, saying that how many you are actually crosstalking each other. It's a huge crosstalk, huge. Every gene knows that something I have to talk to other person. Then only the final function is happening. So these are cell dividing cells. You know, cancer is a non-stop dividing cells. They talk to each other, make sure that everybody is following the rules, and ask them to divide. Okay, so it's not like one person is deciding everything. There is a big network of things. That is a big surprise. And it's not like, you know, every smaller players have a role in this, you know, in every cellular function. These are all quite new insights we have now on biology. For example, if you create a small mutation, okay, this is a c-kit mutation. You get this kind of birthmark in the child, in the belly and the forehead. You see this? And if you do the same mutation in the rat, you get exactly the same kind of birthmarks. It also has a belly shadow and the forehead. So we are so close. Even though we are far away in millions of years of evolution, the genes do almost exactly the same functions. That is a surprise. So that's why we use models to understand how humans have diseases, what kind of diseases, can we solve these issues? Because these animals find out what are the reasons for it and try to understand how the human biology actually functions. So you can solve diseases much more better. Now, many of the human diseases happens because of the mutations. Now, what is a mutation? You know, you might have heard COVID is changing. COVID is mutating. What is mutation? Mutation is nothing but the change in the base. Okay, something is changing in the sequence that I told you about the language. You know, alphabet is there, a language is there. One small spelling mistake, the meaning, it, the whole sentence become meaningless, right? That is what it happens. So let us read this sentence. Okay, this is the one sentence which doesn't make much of a meaning. A woman without a man, without her man is nothing. So let us make it a little more sensible. For example, a woman, comma, without her man is nothing. Okay, so you put two commas around. You change the sentence once again. A woman, you put a colon here, without her, man is nothing. So entirely opposite meanings you can create in the same sentence. Where you put the comma, where you put the colon is the only thing which matters. So that's what it is happening in the mutation. If we change one small change, one colon or one comma here and there, the whole meaning of the protein changes. It cannot do the function properly. So it have an almost like an opposite meaning. So you will have in trouble because I told you this figure where everybody is actually crosstalking. If one guy is not functioning properly, the whole network will fall. This is like an electrical connection, right? If one small fault is enough, whole system will fail. Similar thing happens in biology. So it's very surprising that, that small changes matters a lot. Now we know because of these mutations causes all these things, there are a lot of methodologies has been created. How do we correct this? Can we correct this? Can we introduce some of the systems on that? Okay. So for example, there are methods like, you know, you can create a complex sequences, correcting sequences into the genome, or even you can stop an RNA molecule from translating into a protein. You can switch it off if you want. We call it siRNA technique. You can also ask a particular protein is unable to do a particular function because usually proteins do function by a particular type of folding. It need a structure, particular kind of folded structure is critical. If it is unable to fold in that way, we can have a nanoparticle kind of based catalyst to fold it. You know, people are doing a lot of kind of experiments because we now know where the problem lies and we kind of help it to do the function. So that we will can at least a 50% reduction in that disease formation. We can reduce it. We can improve the quality of life of a patient in a larger extent because it's becoming much more easier accessible because we, our understanding is better now. What is actually happening in the genome? And from the gene in RNA, it is when it is forming, what are the problems in RNA it is happening? We can study that. It's very easy to study now. And looking at the protein, does it have a problem? We can also try to correct it also. And the techniques which we use are very powerful techniques because if you are want to look where the mutations are, that is where the PCR. Now you hear this in the COVID testing. That is a have you done a PCR test? You know this is what the PCR test is all about. You take the gene. You are interested in a particular gene is present or not. You designed a regions, a starting point and ending point of those gene area. And you add some enzymes and all kind of stuffs into the tube. And you just heat and cool. That's what it do. When you, the fundamental principles works in biology here, okay? When you heat, DNA become single stranded because it is a hydrogen bond. It breaks out 95 degree, you heat and becomes single stranded. Then you only thing you have to do is cool it down. When it cools, exactly the same strand will reform again, exactly, without any error. That is the magic of DNA. It will form exactly the same back again. So when you cool it, you know, because you added a synthetic DNA into the reaction, it will bind faster because it's so small. It will sit in there. And we will increase the temperature again so that a new strand of DNA will form. So what happened is that one strand become two. Again, if you cool it again, heat it again, cool it again, it will become another, it doubles each time. So two become four, four become eight become 16. So you have an exponential growth of DNA. So you can detect. If it is a COVID you are detecting, you design the primers, we call it this red ones as primers, so that we can detect COVID is present. Or if you want to know whether a gene is mutated, we can amplify those genes and identify whether there is a mutation exist or not. So it's a very powerful technique, got a Nobel Prize in these experiments. Another experiment, another protocol which we, especially my lab and all, uses is a new protocol called CRISPR-Cas9. You might have heard it a little bit because it got the Nobel Prize last year. It is a very powerful technique at which you can actually design a DNA and say that I want to correct a region of mutation. You can tailor it. Okay, you want to remove one base from the DNA and put a new base, you can use CRISPR. So it has a very powerful, futuristic, all ethical, huge dilemmas exist, because now you can have designer babies if you really want. Okay, and you can remove the diseases. Child is already detected early. You can remove those. Okay, so all those questions coming, are we playing a god now? Okay, can we do all these things? And all those debates, it's good to have debates on that, but these techniques are already there. Techniques are coming. Okay, so these are very powerful techniques. You can introduce even a new gene if you really want to. Okay, so that's why there is a lot of debate on whether the COVID was created by a human in a lab. Somebody might have created COVID there and all, because of these techniques are existing. We can create if you really want. So that is the doubts and all. So what is the take-home message on this one I have talked about? So all living things have a genome. All living biological systems have a genome, which is made of our DNA, basically, and which is have all the instructions how to build our bodies. Okay, so that's how DNA is mainly for, to make cells, cell to divide, when to cells to die, because there is also cell suicide, because that's why we have a particular shape, because why our fingers are projected out, because when we are in the womb, our actually fingers were all fused, and slowly the body decides, it's like a carpenter, you just remove the cells from there and you have a particular shape develops. So that is a peak, planning happens in our body. There's a lot of ideas has been given to the that this should be the shape, this cell should die, this should cell should survive, all are coded. We don't know how it was developed like that, but it's so amazing to watch how it is happening. And in the genome, when you look at it, a person's genome is around 99.9 between two persons, same. This 0.1% difference, we are talking about around 3 million differences. That's the percentage. So there is a lot of difference. That's why each person is different. Minimum. I'll move a little bit from this to genomics of COVID, because that is the topic which I think all of you should understand a little more, because we work on it. So I thought we'll talk about a little bit on that. How this COVID genome is actually changing our views or understanding biology a little more faster now, because a lot of genome studies are happening in COVID. If you look at it, it's an influenza. Influenza is nothing but a fever. Okay, so COVID is also a fever-based disease. Basically, it causes a lot of fever because it is affecting your lungs also. So there is a lot of fluid accumulation in the lungs, and you have breathing problem and all kind of things happens. But if you look at it, we had a lot of influenza, this kind of pandemics, many times in the history it has happened. Okay, but if you look at now, these are the recent years. I don't know whether you can read it. And 2000, these are all around this time onwards, we have more frequent pandemics happening. That is a very scary proposition. We are getting more and more pandemics. We don't know why it is happening. One reason is that deforestation, we removed a lot of animals are living very close by. Forests are lost. So all the viruses, every animal has a virus in its body. So this wild virus, which we never seen before, are coming very close to us. And they are crossing to us. So that is a very dangerous proposition on that. But this is a very, very scary graph. to look at it, it's almost every 20 years and 30 years now, we are getting a pandemic in a small scale sometimes, especially maybe in a country full, okay, and it's scale. If you look at it, no, this COVID, we had, this is the third actually SARS incident in our time. This is actually, this SARS-CoV-2 is usually in a bat, and we had a SARS-CoV-2 in the camel also. We also have SARS in our own SARS-CoV-2. So once this happened, what happened was this SARS of bat and SARS of camel was fused together and made a new virus, which is called as MERS. And that was a killer. 50% of the people who got that died. Okay, it's a very scary incident. It happened in Middle East area. Because of so many people died, it didn't spread. That was the only reason. Otherwise, it was one of the most scariest situation at the time. We are talking about around 30 years back. Now, what happened is this, what we are getting now, this is how the genome sequencing of all this SARS-CoV-2, what we call it now, is happening. Okay, if you look at this, is a tree we call it. You know, this is how it is evolving. It's actually started in a bat. So you can see this branch. This is a branch of a, it is in a bat. So this bat has, and bat and this anteater. Anteater is an animal. He has SARS virus. These two got fused. So this guy came, and this is also fused, and it went back to bat again. So new virus, which is formed now, these two are fused now, and they went to bat. This bat guy again came back and started infecting the anteater again, and to us also. It just crossed the species. So instead of between them now, anteater and the bat, suddenly the species was crossed. It came to human. So it came fast, you know, at the same time when it is this new virus, which is fused virus, which is came, it actually jumped the species. It is still infecting the anteater, but it is, if you look at the line, length of the line, it is slightly changed from what we have. So the length of the bar is always looks like how many changes actually happen. So we are not changed that much. So this is how it crossed. It's a very strange cross. If you look at it in a very few bases, only it has changed between these guys. And by the time it is actually able to adapt to human, that's what it has happened. And this is how the SARS-CoV-2's genome look like. It has multiple genes. It has, it's an RNA virus. It has multiple genes. And if you look at it, you know, there are major variation. I have a slide coming. Major variations are actually happening in these two genes. Okay, this is how it is adapting now, mainly adapting and going through this S genomes, okay, spike proteins, which is what it is changing. You can ask the question, why we did not get the first wave that much? You know, first wave was okay, we were thinking, you know, we were almost opened up the country in January, December and all. Everybody was even talking about this, let the schools open and all. Then we got in from February onwards, we had a big peak, right? Now we are going to get another peak also. Okay, huge, another huge peak is coming. Why we didn't get that much in the first time? That was a debated topic. You know, a lot of people say a lot of reasons and all. The reason was, you know, you look at this. This is actually, you know, the virus started in China. And this is the green guy. China virus was the green virus, okay? So what we actually got was exactly the China's virus, okay? And you, the blue one is different and the red one is a, some variations happened in the virus, right? So let us see this. This is a cluster one, which is, was only very restricted to India and China. But when it went to Europe, it started changing into blue. And in US also, it was starting in blue. And in the Brazil, it was changing into red. So we have these three graphs, right? green, red, and blue. Okay, so let us focus on these three. And there are some reds coming in the in England, in UK and Europe, okay, in Spain and all. And if you look at them, so I'm still following the same green, red, and the blue, okay? And these are the countries where these are coming. So you can see China, India, okay, Korea, Japan, okay? So they have very less mutations. If you see that, this is the original Chinese variations. Look at the other red guys. They have a huge variation happening in one of the gene called ORF1B. A huge, this red means maximum variation, 75% variations are happening. So a lot of mutations are happening here. It's the red one. Blue one also has some mutation, but he has a random here, somewhat here. These regions are getting mutated. Some other genes are getting mutated here. So there are mutations are happening. And what happened in India was, we didn't get that, we got the original guy without much mutation came in the first wave. That's what is actually happened. And that form, this green form, was very resistant to BCG. I mean, very sensitive to BCG. So who in our country, we all take BCG. When we are kids, we take BCG vaccine. And this is a very sensitive to it, and they will all die. So that's why we didn't get in the first wave, all are BCG sensitive vaccines. So this I'm taking from the paper. If you look at that, this is a BCG countries. Okay, so mortality rate was very low. Fatality rate was very low, but there are one country, you can see these are all each countries, okay. I circled one country, this is Brazil. Brazil is also highly vaccinated. And if you look at the fertility rate here also, you know, the fatality rate, Hungary, Brazil is very high. And also there is a outliers. These are all Brazil and all countries, okay? Brazil is also highly BCG vaccinated country. And I showed you here, Brazil is already mutating. And it was the scariest proposition. This paper came in last year, 2020, September, okay? So there are scientists who are aware that it's only time we are going to get this Brazil variant and this UK variants, which were having a lot of mutation, that are the red genes, these are the red guys, who is having a lot of variations, are going to come to us. And it came. And which is resistant to BCG. So whether we had BCG vaccine or not, doesn't matter. This virus will attack us. So that's why we got a second peak so high. So many people died. Now, if you look at it, this virus is changing dramatically. So many variants now. We are talking about huge variations are happening. Each tree is a new guy. We are talking about this is the now latest guys. Look at them. All of them are coming with a very different genome profiles. A lot of variations are happening in them. Okay. So that is very scary. Very scary in many ways. You know, why 614? You know, this is the latest paper. Why everybody is scared that vaccine may not prevent us? The third wave, we should prevent. We should not, we should wear a mask. We should vaccinate as quickly as possible. We are talking about mainly because there is a huge danger of this virus is going through. And it is actually changing. Dramatically changing. For example, this is one of the protein in the virus, which is, we call it a spike protein. Okay, it has two regions, S1, which is a light color, S2, which is a dark blue. These two regions are there, okay? Before it get infected, usually the old earlier version of it, this S1 used to get shredded. It will breaken off from the protein and only S2 stays. And it has a very low infection rate. Now, this new variant, G614, it doesn't remove this S1. S1 stays with it. If S1 stays stronger along with it, what we are finding that this will be more infectious because it can bind to human proteins much, much better so that it can attack us far better than the older guys, where this S1 was removed and only S2 it has. Now it has an S1 and S2, and it has a very nice pocket at which it can sit around our cells and enter into our cells. So that is where the danger is. So this, we should be very, very careful about this virus. It is going to be very highly infectious. We should never remove your mask. I would rather advise you, never, okay? And that is the best protection we have now. Vaccinate, kids cannot get vaccinated yet, but every adult should get vaccinated as quickly as possible. So when the virus infection came last year, in the beginning of last year, so we were also, you know, there was a romantic relationship, I just call it nowadays this. We also had a very strong romantic relationship with COVID. We thought that we should control this and it will go away. We all thought that it will be only 6 months and everything will be okay. So we were all excited to work on it. So that's how I entered into it. So when the COVID started, there was a lot of crisis because it is a pandemic. And every country is infected, right? And in India, we used to import all the molecular biology enzymes and kits and everything has to be imported in India. We didn't have anything in India, including our lab. You know, when we do research, we buy from abroad. We don't have anything. In India, nobody sells anything. So because it's very, you know, expensive, chemicals are very expensive and very less labs work, you know, so there is only a few companies in the world who makes all these things. So naturally there was less demand and only few customers. When the pandemic came, you know, all these only few companies are there and they all started selling to the rich countries. So India, first crisis India faced was, because it's an RNA virus and we have to isolate RNA from the virus to start do a testing even, okay? So there is no kit for RNA isolation. That was a crisis. So, but our lab, you know, we used to work on RNA. So we had a RNA kit already developed and we had a small patent also on it. So we thought that we should give it immediately into the market. So this kit came within 1.5 months. We are talking about May, this was released into the market. We immediately sold this. We give it to the company. We validated in ICMR and it was 100% accurate. And today, surprise, today I was doing this slide and I got this news. Suddenly I got a message from Government of India that World Economic Forum was discussing about our work. Okay, today they posted this. That 5 COVID trends from Indian entrepreneurs. They talked about Srijitra Tirunal Institute of Medical Sciences has developed an RNA kit and approved within few months. That's what they written. And this was a case study for them in this article. You can go and check this article. Our kit was a case study, very nice to read, you know, because that was not our intention at that time. We wanted to help somehow. And it was very interesting to see that, you know, international forums are discussing about our small, you know, approaches we have taken on that. We then, you know, looked at another problem, you know, because one of the major problem now in the COVID testing is that, you know, you might have heard that even PCR started failing. RT-PCR, when you do a test, sometimes you get negative, but you are actually COVID positive and you may start showing symptoms. And it is a very confusing, you know, because if the diagnosis fails, then you will spread more, right? So that was a very scary proposition. And we were started looking at what should we get out of this? You know, we should have an alternate because all the kits, which is for the PCR came last year when the COVID was started. Now the genome is changing. And the PCR is again based on the genes you selected and those genes, if it is mutated, your PCR may fail. So we started looking at, is there any region in the COVID which is not mutating? So that will be a very good target so that we will not miss this virus. So we identified a small region we'll call as NSP14, this gene over here. Okay, this never mutate in COVID because if it is mutated, the COVID will die. Okay, so this is a, nowadays a target for drugs also. People are looking that can we stop this gene so that virus can be stopped from multiplying. So we thought that we will use this gene as a target, and we developed a RT-PCR kit which was validated in ICMR. We got this kind of result, specificity 100% and sensitivity 90%. So this ICMR has approved this, and it is coming next week into the market. So it's already packed by a company in Hyderabad. It is going to come in. So that is the next contribution we are trying to do. We are also working on, you know, another aspect is whether we can sequence the genome of COVID. Because now you know, in Kerala, yesterday was 22,000 patients positive. That is scary number because we are going up, right? More and more people are getting COVID. So how do we stop this? You know, it's a close down is not a solution. What should we do? You know, that is the biggest question now. So one way of doing is we should identify if the virus is mutating or not. If it is mutating, isolate that person or that family, that group of people, so that this mutated virus will not come to the next person. It will not be able to attack. So only way to is find it out. Okay. So sequencing is the option. Sequencing is an expensive proposition, but there is a new sequencing machines has come. This is a new latest machine, which is a new technology, which is using a very adventurous way of sequencing genome. So we are establishing this machine. It's coming from UK. Trying to establish this by within a couple of weeks in my lab, and to understand whether the genome sequencing can be done on COVID. So to help, which are the areas we should actually close down, which are the areas we need not close down, because it may be some of the areas where the viruses are not that harmful, you know, not a mutant, because you cannot close down everything, you know, that economy is going to fall. There's a huge problem in a country like ours where, you know, we have to work, right? And a lot of poor people are there, you know. So there are a lot of issues in a country. Close down is not a solution, not the only solution we can have. So we should identify where the close down can happen. So that is the proposition on that. So I'll close here. Thank you very much for listening to me. You can ask me questions which you have. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Anup, for the wonderful talk on genetics, genomic, and current pandemic situation. Over to the question answer session. Participants are requested to ask questions in the Zoom chat box or Slido.com. In Slido.com, there are two questions. First one, if COVID-19 was a virus with variable properties, would the vaccine still be effective against it?
Vaccine is against one particular protein in the virus. Okay, it's called a spike. Okay, S protein. So vaccine should work because why people have selected that particular protein? Because that is the protein surface of the virus. So antibodies will see this. Whenever we have vaccination, basically we are making antibodies in our body. So antibodies will see this protein, it will attack this protein, and virus will be dead. So that will be active a lot of time, like a majority of the time. So that's why it is, that's the ideal candidate. So I don't think that will be a bigger problem. There will be an efficiency because that paper I was showing, this S protein is changing because now it is a complex S protein is virus is trying to maintain. Maybe a strategy, it's a game. You know, you see, you should understand you are trying to kill the virus, right? Virus is a living organism. He wanted to live. So he will figure out how do I live. And because we are also living organism, we are trying to find out how do we live. So it's a game between two living organisms. So we will also, in our body also, there will be a lot of mechanism by which we will also have a preventive planning because we have our own cells knows what to do and all. That's why there is not that much mortality. If you think about it, people are not dying because of COVID that much, right? Mainly because we know how to attack. Our body also knows how to attack. And virus So also want a host. So they will be have a balance somewhere. It will reach after some time. That is a hope now. This virus will stay with us forever. Just like, you know, we get fever once in a year. Now we will have a COVID fever once in a year. So that should be, you know, it should be become harmless to a level. That's what we are hoping. Finally, it will end up like that. But till that time, we should be very careful. I mean, it has to reach. The virus doesn't know why it is mutated. That is a plus point of our side. Okay, because virus have no idea why it is mutating. It is just mutating. So finally, it will destroy itself by mutating something which is very essential, and it will mutate itself. That is what one another hope we have. But if he is planning something, just like we plan, then it is dangerous. Okay, so these are the reasons. Because vaccination, all of a sudden, the two things happened in scientifically, if you look at it in COVID, some people say it is a wrong strategy we made. We should not have vaccinated so early, people say, because the virus is so much, it is there in around. When you vaccinate now, virus will figure out how to escape vaccine, right? Because it has so much in number. So if you reduce, if the virus load was less and people are very less people have COVID, at that time, if you are vaccinating, it would have been much more efficient. That's what the one guess. But we have no choices. In a pandemic, we have no choice. We have to somehow stop this. So I don't think a vaccine will have a problem immediately. Unless there are, for example, Johnson & Johnson's vaccine has started showing failure. So there is some concern. Because of these new variants which is coming. So we should not allow new variants to form. So we should vaccinate as quickly as possible.
Thank you, sir. The second question is from Godwin Biju Thomas. Does the coronavirus have a lipid layer? If yes, is that the reason why we are advised to wash hands regularly?
Because it has a cell membrane, you know. It has a membrane outside. It is not because of washing the hands regularly. It's nothing to do with the lipid layer and all. Okay, because all this cell, because it need a, it has no existence outside a cell. The virus cannot stay outside. Okay, it need a host immediately. It need a moisture situation. It will get kind of hibernate and keep together. That's all. Unless it can only multiply when it just reaches in a cell and attach and introduce its genome inside. So you wash your hand, don't touch your eyes. All of these are the normal prevention mechanism of any microbes in the environment. You clean your hands. Hands are the biggest, you touch everyone. So you'll get it.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Milan Abraham. Will COVID-19 affect on other microorganisms?
It won't. Because it is not attacking any microbes. It only attacks mammalian cells because it cannot divide in a prokaryotic system. In a microbe, it cannot do. Okay, so this is a different, each virus is different. There are some viruses which attack microbes, okay? But this virus is a human or mammalian cells where a nucleus is needed and it's, about virus biology, I those who are scared enough about reading about, don't read it. Okay, but this virus is very dangerous. Okay, that's why I'm telling you a lot of warning. Don't take it lightly. If you're at home, you ask your parents to be always on mask. Ask them to, when they reach home, ask them to wash before touching you. All those has to be done because this is very dangerous virus because it doesn't require anything from us. It needs only our cell. It has everything inside. It know how to make a new RNA from itself. It doesn't require anything from us. Only it requires a place to stay. We are the place to stay. That's a problem. Okay. So it is very dangerous guy. Very unusual virus, okay, and it is infecting very fast than any other virus we know so far. Extremely fast it's infecting. And because we do a lot of this test kit and all we are developing, we know when the COVID started in the last year. When a patient comes and when we test how much virus is present in their body, it was very low. You know, you may detect it as a positive, but he is having very less virus. Now, if I test in any patients coming to Sri Chitra or some other places, it's very scary. You have billions of virus in each patient. So that means the virus is so much in even one person inside. He just walks near you, you may get it. That's the stage now. So we should be very careful about it. So now, especially our country, we have so many people, crowdy, we have less hygiene, a lot of issues we have, and it's a very dangerous situation we are in. We must be very careful.
Thank you, sir. Renu Susan Kurin is asking, can biotechnology bring newer technologies to the world, and what would be the possible new inventions?
Quite a lot of inventions are happening. You know, I think this is the right time to come to biology. As a student, what is the science people used to talk about? The best science was chemistry, physics, mathematics were the best science. Because why we call it as a best science? Because anything very you can predict is a good science. For example, in physics, you can predict. Professor Nainan will know. You know how much energy should be given for a satellite to go or a rocket to be launched. How much energy has to be given. So it is well calculated, and it will go to the orbit. So you can calculate before even you launch, you know this much is needed. This is the payload, this much energy is required, this much it should go. In biology, people thought that we don't know what is happening. Those days are gone. Now biology is highly predictable. I can predict which are the diseases you are going to get by just looking at your genome. Okay, that much powerful it is. Okay, I can say that you will get at this particular age, you can get a Parkinson's disease, you can get this disease, that disease, and all. I'm talking about incurable diseases, we can even predict. So there is no point in knowing it, okay, unless other than worrying about it. But it just becomes so powerful. That's what I'm saying. So there are techniques coming, new techniques every day. So biology, now if you look at who are all getting Nobel Prize in biology or medicine, are people are from chemistry and physics are coming to biology. Because they find that this is very interesting because it is very predictable now and a lot of things are unknown. So you can work on it, how an RNA is actually folded, how RNA knows that when I should produce a protein, but this is a switch for it. How a protein knows that I should go to a membrane and sit on a membrane. Some proteins doesn't sit on a membrane. Why? Okay, so all those questions you can ask and you can understand that. And it's become very, very exciting time for a biology science in general.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Rohan Ranjit. Can we genetically engineer human to have superpowers like camouflage?
Because you cannot do any experiment on human. Okay, that is banned. You cannot even clone. You can clone, if you know that there is a goat was cloned, a new goat was made from the mother, from the cell, just took the cell and it become another goat. But that technology is there, but you cannot do any experiment on human. Okay, that is banned, So that's why all this CRISPR and all, we don't allow any of this work done on human beings. So, because we don't know what we are actually doing. You can do a lot of things in biology now, but you become a god then, So are we enough sufficiently know that these things can be done like this? Because how science actually created bad and good things, right? When we invented car and all, we thought it is very nice to have car and all this. Now we know, how much pollution it is creating, right? Our environment is polluted because of so many cars in the road. So all this invention has a backward part of it. One aeroplane travel is enough for you to destroy the world. Now this tourist going to the space, think about it, how much pollution it is being created in. So all those are inventions have this sidetrack, it happens in human also. So we don't know. So better not to touch. For example, now you know that tomatoes, we have genetically engineered tomatoes. Okay, you can buy in US and all, you can buy. In Germany and all, it is banned now because people think that I should not eat genetically modified things because we don't know what we are doing. It's because of insect, you know, you have insect resistant genes are introduced into the tomato. So insect cannot eat tomato now because it's toxin for the insect. So that is become, instead of pesticide, you put a gene inside. Now this gene we are eating, now we don't know what will happen to us also, right? These are the problems, you know, we don't know what we are doing. We have a solution, just like pesticide we used long back for agriculture revolution. Now you think about pesticides, you know, we want organic food now. So those are the signs, you know, how it is goes.
Thank you, sir. There are many questions regarding COVID-19. Will antiretroviral drugs can cure COVID-19? Those who even have serious stage of COVID-19?
Yeah, I mean, antiviral drugs are all effective. Very, very effective.
Yes. Antiretroviral drugs.
They're very expensive, right? All these antiviral drugs are retroviral drugs. Very, very expensive. No, so that's one of the biggest problems, because in a pandemic, we are talking about, you know, millions of people getting infected, and who should get these medicines, you know, very expensive medicine. We are talking about now antibody as a test, you know, as a drug. Very expensive. You know, if you think about it, a lot of treatment available for COVID. You know, COVID is very treatable disease. Only thing you have to detect early. COVID, nobody is going to die with COVID if you are detected very early stages. You should not wait till you are in the last stage where you don't have able to breathe. Don't wait till that. You know, you should have a fever. You take, you know, think about the power of science now. You know, COVID is a very good example. I like you are asking a lot of questions on COVID. Think about a technology now, before even the disease start, now you can detect you have the virus in your body. We never had such kind of diagnosis before. Even though this PCR and all existed before, we never tested like this. Now, even on the day one you got a virus, it can be detected. You didn't have any symptoms. You don't even have a cough. But it can be detected that you are carrying this virus. So that's the power of science. You know, it's so powerful now. So that's a big thing we have in our hand. We can control this kind of diseases. And think about what the future looks like in medicine. All these techniques now will be commonly used. Now, you have a tomorrow a fever, it will be immediately detected which is causing the fever now, you know, because all this information was available because nobody was using it earlier. Now, we know about these terms. You will also ask the doctor that, why are you not doing a PCR for me? So that will be the condition. Okay, so that will be, it's a very change, big change in medicine, treatment. So it's a revolutionary system. You know, look at this also, you know, nearly around 100 people can sit together and we can talk, right? We never thought that is possible. Interact with each other. You know, look at this, you know, revolutionizing the techniques which we have existed. I mean, you think that Zoom did not exist before COVID? Zoom was there, but we never used it. Just like that. Okay.
Okay, sir. Ashmit is asking, can genetically modified crops can help us to fight against food scarcity?
Of course. That's a plan. You know, that is the plan always people are talking about, because if you can resist the insect and you have a better crop production, that was the same argument we put it on pesticide also. When we have pesticide, insects died, we have better crops, better food supply and all. Now what happened to the insect? They become resistant to the pesticide, right? So that is a danger. Now any living organism, you try to stop them, they will find a way. That is the problem. So now you are putting a gene. Pesticide you can remove somehow, little bit. And when you put a gene inside an organism, a crop, how do you destroy that crop? You find tomorrow there is a problem in that gene which I put it in. How do you destroy that plant? It's very difficult to destroy. This plant will also is a living organism now. He will find a way to live. It's become a serious consequence. That's what everybody is warning. Can we do all these things? We may have a lot of knowledge base, but can we play with the nature? You know, whenever we play with the nature, there is a problems. You know, that's what this COVID and all are teaching us. There is a lot of things we don't know is happening in life. And we should not play too much. Also, we may interested in know a lot of things, but we should not experiment to create a new forms of living. You know, that is not very safe because we don't have that much knowledge yet. That's why. But it is a main aim is to have a food, maximize the food. So that is the argument everybody likes, right? But the consequences, we don't know. Long-term consequences.
Sir, thank you. The next question is from Shreya. Is there any genetically engineered virus?
In labs, yes. Including my lab. We create a lot of things in the lab. Okay. I have nearly around 150 different worms in my lab, which is not normal worms, which have so many other new characters it has. So which is we do, that's how we do in the lab. You know, if it's a virus lab, virus guy will be creating all kind of new genetically modified viruses in his lab. He may have a question to ask. So these are all happens inside the lab, but none of the scientists will put this outside. Okay, I don't believe that it is a lab created and you know, all kind of viruses are coming from labs and all. I don't think that argument is not right. Scientists are much more responsible people. So I don't think they will do that. But it is possible. Yes, it can be created easily. Easily can be created.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Madhavan R. Vijayan. Is it possible to create an organism that destroy bacteriophages on bacteria?
That's a hypothetical question. Bacteria are fed by some other organism, is it not? You know, many organism feeds on bacteria. I mean, there is a life. I mean, you have a food cycle, right? So everybody is a food of somebody. You know, so it goes on like that. So I don't think there should be a discovery for that. But there is a choices. You know, so. I don't think bacteriophages and all are very dangerous system. These are all existing always. In the nature, if you look at it, all coexist. Everybody has a role in it. Just like, you know, we thought about earthworms are not needed. You know, earthworms are very essential for the soil to fertilize, right? So these are all, you know, a cycle of it. You know, it may look like, you know, may not be needed and may not be needed. Life is the environment and, you know, whole nature has its own rules. And you destroy those rules, that is a problem.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Milan. Is there any machine to understand a virus early before it affects?
Of course. You know, that's what the PCR and all. You know, you can detect the virus. If there is a virus present. Because any genetic material is there, we can detect. Anybody is having a genetic material, we can differentiate immediately. So we are talking about, you know, 5 to 10 viruses is enough for me to detect. That is the sensitivity of detection now. 5 copies. We are talking about, you're taking a swab from your nose, put it into a solution of 5 ml. From there, we take only 1 drop of it. In that drop, 5 viruses are there, I'll detect. That is a sensitivity of detection now. So it's very powerful, extremely powerful way of detecting systems. So it's already exists. So that is so easy to figure it out.
Thank you, sir. The next question, is bat resist to SARS-CoV-2?
Can you repeat
bat, that? Whether bat resist to SARS-CoV-2?
No, bat doesn't have any symptoms because it is a native virus for it. Okay. We are the new host. See, the problem happens is that because whenever a host is changed, we never seen this virus before, right? So naturally we will react. So till this virus shows less resistance or adapting, we also feel like, okay, he is also not that dangerous. Till that time, there will be a reaction between each other. If you look at it, we have SARS virus, H1N1 is there with us. We have it in our body. We also have a lot of viruses living with us. Each one is a host of something because virus need a host. So we also carry a lot of viruses as a host. So each organism has one. Now the problem started is that as long as we keep our own virus, there is no problem. Now we cross. If, for example, our virus goes to a dog, or think about there is a virus called parvo. Okay, it infects the dog, and the dogs usually bleed and die. High fever and they will bleed. Think about that virus coming to us. Every dog gets almost every. We have a vaccine for parvo against parvo, but think about getting that virus to us. So hopefully, so far it has not crossed to human. That's all we have. So tomorrow it find a way and start crossing to us. And this is the dangerous sign. So far in the history, many of the time, very rarely only species crossing happens from one host to another host. Now it has become pretty common. It is happening every 5 years, 10 years, this crossing is starting to come. We don't know why. A lot of theories are there. A lot of environmental change theories are the one which is everybody talking about. Environment is changing, virus is threatened, its existence are questioned. So it is finding the best host. Who is the best host in the world? Human. We are largest in number. So they are finding we are the best host to get. So that is very unfortunate.
Thank you, sir. This is the last question in the chat box. In your field of view, N95 mask, which one is better? N95 mask or surgical mask?
N95, no doubt. Okay, surgical mask has no protection that much because you have to cover, because you should breathe through the mask. It should be tightly fit. So if you are using a surgical mask, use a cloth mask also so that it's tightly on your face. If you are breathing, just putting a mask and you are breathing from all other sides of your face, then it doesn't have any filtration. Basically, you're wearing a mask to filter your air. So that's what you're doing. So N95 is the most safest.
Nithi, are we through most of the questions?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then I think we can pass on. If anybody wish to have a personally some interaction with Dr. Anu, maybe after we close, after the prayers and vote of thanks, a couple of questions. I think you will agree, Dr. Anu. Okay. Carry on.
Gratitude is when memory is stored in the heart and not in the mind. Good evening to all. I, Ganga V. Nair from Lekko Chibuka, Serene Valley, have been presented with a wonderful opportunity of presenting the vote of thanks on today's session of the JMM lecture series on the exciting possibilities in molecular genetics and genomics. I would firstly like to thank the eminent speaker, Dr. Anup Kumar Thekkavetil, Senior Scientist and Head of Division of Molecular Medicine at Sri Chitra Thirumal Institute for Medical Sciences and Technology for conducting the fantastic session. Sir, the talk enabled us to get an idea of molecular biology, how the discoveries on DNA structures, genes, and gene regulations altered our understanding of biology, and also an insight about the technologies that allow us to understand the disease process and early diagnosis. I thank Reverend Linwin C. Thomas and Reverend Manoj Idikula, who led us in the prayers, as prayer is putting oneself in the hands of God. I express my sincere gratitude to Associate Director of JMM Study Center, Reverend Dr. K. Jameson, and convener of its current awareness forum, Dr. K. N. Nayanan, for taking the effort to organize these sessions for our students. Thank you, sirs, for playing a far-reaching role in all our futures. I thank Dr. Deepthi Shivadas, scientist at BSSC, who had coordinated the Q&A session and made sure that all our curious queries were answered. I express my sincere thanks to the beloved Vice Principal of L'Ecole Champaka Serene Valley, Mrs. Anandi Krishna, for giving me the opportunity to perform this prestigious task. I thank my dear friend and schoolmate, Ishana and Jobin, for welcoming and introducing the honorable guests. I would like to express my sincere thanks to the technical and media team comprising of Reverend Ashish Thomas George, Robin Thomas, Mr. Sibi Palichira, and Mr. George Uman, who made the seamless YouTube streaming and Zoom meeting possible. I thank all teachers and parents for attending today's session. We stay indebted to you for a lifetime for your support. I thank all the students who have registered for the program and those who interacted animatedly with the respected speakers, making the sessions vivid and interesting. Lastly, and most importantly, I thank God Almighty for giving me the opportunity to express my gratitude to all present here today through this vote of thanks. I wish everyone very illuminating sessions ahead and hope you all make the best use of them. Thank you and good night.
Thank you.
I request Mr. George Uman, one of the well-wisher of JMM Study Center, to lead us in closing prayer.
Let's bow our heads for prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful evening. Lord, we thank you for the JMM Study Center. We praise you for this meaningful work and benefits received by the community and society. Thank you, Lord, for the lecture series organized through the JMM Study Center. Lord, we pray that the study center and the ongoing lecture series be very beneficial to each and every participant present here. Thank you, Lord, for the leaders of this organization, our Barnabas Tirimini, James Sinachan, and others office bearers. Father, Lord, strengthen them to do more meaningful and fruitful work for the society and people. Also, we thank you for Anoop sir for this fruitful session. Lord, strengthen him to do more for the society and also for our nation. We thank you and pray for everyone who is part of this event and present here. Lord, give us the wisdom and discipline to stay calm during this pandemic situation. May your healing hand be shown to this world so that we can overcome these tough days. Keep all of us in your safe hands. We ask all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
May the grace, peace, and blessings of the triune God, God the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. I take this opportunity to thank, on behalf of JMM, to Dr. Anoop Thekumootil for the meaningful and very relevant lecture he has given us. It was very informative. Once again, thank you, sir. Thank you very much. We wish all the best and offer our praise in all your ventures. God bless. Especially thanks to the principal, teachers, and the students of Trivandrum L'Ecole Champaka Serene Valley School for hosting this program on behalf of JMM Study Center. Thank you for meaningful virtual choir also. Thank you very much. Once again, thanks to Dr. Deepthi. Your involvement in this lecture series is very dynamic. Once again, thank you. Thanks to Dr. Nayanan sir for the leadership. Once again, let me especially thank all the parents, teachers, and all the participants who have participated in this program. So our next session will be next Friday, evening 6 o'clock, that will be led by Dr. Jobin Srek on the topic, The Amazing World of Nanomaterials. Wish you all the best. God bless. So we will continue our interaction with Dr. Anoop Thekumootil. The floor is open.
Thank you, Achan. Now, those of you who missed asking questions, you can ask in person, but I prefer one by one. Dr. Anoop, it was a really wonderful lecture, and many, many things have been unraveled, which are not known to many of us. Okay, floor is open.
Sir, can you hear me?
Hi.
I am Milan Abraham Vargas.
Okay.
Sir, how brain foods help us help our brain to make our memory sharper?
You should read. Okay, reading is the best way to sharpen your memory. If you watch a TV and all those things, doesn't give a lot of information to the brain. When you read something, what happened is that brain has to imagine, you know, when you read a story, for example, it has to imagine the character. It has to imagine how the person might look like and how this whole plot must be happening. Your imagination improves. But if you watch a TV or something, everything is given to you. Now you just watch, you know, so you only one kind of information comes to the brain. So you should read a lot. That's the best way to sharpen your brain, you know, because we are hardly using, you know, less than 10% of our brain. One of the biggest problem in the brain is that if you don't use it, they die. The brain has to be used, you know, so that's why teachers and all have better brain. Because they use all the time, you know, they have to think about it. How do I teach tomorrow? How do I do this? You know, they have planning a lot. Right. Teachers have a better, you know, they have very few teachers have neurodegenerative diseases so far. Good teachers I'm talking about. Because they have to think about it, you know, how should I make students understand this? They change the way the teach classes are done, you know, a lot of ways they plan. But those who don't do that kind of, you know, things will have a lot of issues, you know. So especially now, if you see that, you know, a lot of watching TVs and video games and all has its own changes in the nervous system. Neuron has this plan, you know, if you like me, you make me excited. Okay, so that's why you become addicted to something, because that particular neuron you have, you know, you induce, that will become very, it likes that. So you may start doing it again and again and again. Okay, so that's why this addiction pathway comes in. So same thing, you can convert it into a learning pathway. You know, if you learn something also, that same such of neurons will start firing and you start, oh my God, this is a new thing. This is a new thing. So that more and more neurons will get involved in it. You use only less. So we think about, you know, if you use, you know, double the current usage, you know, because less than 10%, and you think about 20% of the brain is, will be a supercomputer kind of thing. You know, it's unbelievable power the brain is having. So sharpness of the brain is just reading. Make a habit of reading novels, not your textbooks. I'm saying that read novels and all, you know, so that, you know, stories, so it will give a lot of imagination. Your brain will, you know, really get better and better as your understanding also will improve. Because once you started understanding a story well, you understand your classes also well. Because everything is a story, you know, science is also a story. So you started getting the plots proper. You see, oh, this is what the mystery was. This is what they were trying to solve it. If you come to my lab, you know, I'll tell you why I'm working on this. Well, I'll tell you a story about it. You know, so there is a story in everything. You know, we are trying to figure it out. You know, you ask Professor Nayanan and he'll say that this was failing because of this energy was not sufficient. It's a story. So how you solve that story? You increase that. I change this payload. I change the design of it. You know, all those comes along with as a part of the story of it. And finally, you solve the problem. So basically, life is all about solving problems, right? Finding out interesting answers in things. So you'll figure it out.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Oh. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. I think
anybody else?
Sir?
Yes.
Okay. Sir, my name is Advait. Sir, I would like to ask, what else can we do to increase our, like, 10% usage of our brains? is it possible or in, is any other organism or animals or something having more than this 10%?
10% of the brain, we have the biggest brain. You know, we are one of the biggest brain animal is human being, right? You know, we don't know why we are not using the whole brain. You know, that is one surprising thing. Two things happens in the brain if you look at it. You know, brain, that cells don't divide, the nervous system, neurons don't divide. They don't divide mainly because, you know, you are keeping memories. That's the one reason why it is. Because once you started dividing and started dying, and your memory is also gone. So that is one reason it's keeping constant. But it was dividing till your age of around 4 to 5 years. So that's why people say that, you know, you, that's why people sending you to school only after 5 years. You know, nowadays you send it early, but you should not send children before. They have to have a lot of experience. You know, neurons started having a plan, you know, the mother kind of stuff. You know, one best example of how brain function is you study your mother tongue. Okay, Malayalam, for example, you know, whatever mother tongue you have. Nobody teaches you that. You know, your mother tells you something, you understand that and you learn it. You know, you don't think about the grammar of it that much. When it comes to school only, you started, oh my God, this is complex, this language, right? Till that time, you don't worry about it. But you think about a second language, it's how difficult to learn that, right? So many grammars and so many rules, you know. So brain functions very differently. And this has been seen in patients with Alzheimer's. I don't know how many of you heard about this disease. Alzheimer's disease is by which you forget. Your memories are gone slowly because neurons are dying in the brain. And Alzheimer's patients will lose, last memory they lose is their mother tongue. Surprisingly. Their second language, some other language they learned earlier, all these will start slowly. Mother tongue, they will, the last thing they will. So there is a different way our brain stores information. That's a big surprise. And especially, you know, if I show a picture of your mother, you know, and take a scan of your brain, where it is recognized, you see that one particular region of the brain, and especially on the right side, and it will start firing. And if I show Narendra Modi's picture, our prime minister's picture, entirely different region of the brain will fire. The same pictures, and one picture has been shown, but you know, you're storing Narendra Modi in a different place because you think that after some time he will, you know, he will fail in the election and some other prime minister will. So, but your mother is very precious for you. So those informations are stored in a very specific areas in the brain. Okay, so there is a very different way of storage inside the brain. So we have no idea why it, how it is compartmentalizing this information, how it is storing. We know that during our sleep is the one we store information. That we know. Because whatever you heard today, you're storing in a region called hippocampus. That's a small region in the brain. It's there. It is, there is a place it is stored. And some of the things I told you, may, you might like it very much. And that you will store into the outer region, the cortex, the outer region of the brain, the big brain, there you transfer. When you, during your sleep, that's what you do. How it is transferred from one neuron to another, we have no idea. Because you have to clean this hippocampus tomorrow because you have to learn new things tomorrow. So hippocampus will take a new information because it will be emptied when you sleep. All the information has been removed. So if I remove your hippocampus today, for example, removed your hippocampus. Tomorrow, you will not remember anything I told you. But if I remove it tomorrow, you will remember everything I said today. That means it is transferred. Okay, and when to again remember, you don't need a hippocampus. You can remember through other pathways. But you cannot learn anything new if there is a hippocampus missing. So these are the things which we know. But we don't know how it is transferring into a brain. And even another strange thing happens in the memory and your how brain process the information is that it is not like a computer. You will add something extra, whatever I am saying, because you know some of the things extra. You think that, oh, this I know, you add into that information. It's not a like a copying you do. You don't copy information. Brain works very different way compared to computers. Computers store information. We don't store information. Information is for our understanding rather than storing. That's why we forget also. That's one major, we don't know how we forget. That's another big puzzle. Because we are using very less percentage of brain. So we are learning and newer things. The older memories has to be removed. That's what it is doing. It is just removing the old ones and which you are not using and store the new ones.
Sir,
yeah.
Is eating meat one of the factors why we have an increasing rate in infections and new viruses?
Eating
what?
Meat.
Oh, meat. I don't think so. I mean, it is not, meat is not our natural food. And if you ask me, humans are not made for eating meat at all. That's why we are supposed to cook the meat. No, we cannot have a raw meat eating. So it's not our original diet per se. But I don't think that is not the reason. But there are a lot of, we started eating unusual things like bat, for example. That's what in China and all, they have very unusual habits of foods. Plus, deforestation, a lot of new foods are coming, very unusual wildlife animals you started eating. These are dangerous, Plus, there are other things, nowadays chickens are grown in a mass, in a farm where there's thousands of chickens side by side. They can have a viral infection that you can get it. And a lot of issues are there. But if you think that way, all the foods are now dangerous, whether it is plant or animal in that say. But I don't think that is a reason for it. But major reason, I think, is we destroyed the environment. We destroyed it. We changed the forest. We destroyed it. We have made everything become human habitat. Those are the major changes we made. And that is one of the biggest consequences we are facing at the moment. Environmental change, plus once the environment changes, these viruses will shift to the next best adapted animal. That is, we are the best adapted animal. And they're moving to us because they're thinking that their host is going to die. If a bat is going to die, for example, all the bats are going to die, where the virus will go? Virus will think that I'll find a new home, right? So he is smart and he will move in. That's what he is doing.
Okay, then.
Sir, one more doubt.
Okay. One more question.
Sir, when we sleep, our brain also sleeps. It rests.
No, brain never sleeps. Brain never sleeps.
Okay.
Yeah, if you during your sleep, if I take your how the brain functions, the maximum functioning of the brain is happening when you're actually sleeping. It's using a lot of energy inside. You'll see that, as if it is talking, you'll see the signals coming out of the brain. So during sleep is the maximum activity. It is figuring out what should I store, what should I not store, what is the information, where I should put it, which filing cabinet I should put this information. All are decided at that time. So our brain never sleeps. That's all. I mean, many of the organs don't sleep. Brain also never sleeps.
Okay, then thank you.
Nainan, sir, one more. Godwin, yeah. Godwin, any questions from you?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Good evening, sir. Sir, I'm Godwin. So my question is, why is RNA virus more dangerous than DNA virus?
That is not like that. Because RNA virus, DNA virus, there's dangerous, it's only a kind of perception. Both can be seriously difficult. Theoretically, if you look at RNA virus, should be less dangerous because it is more susceptible to degradation. Okay. And I will be more worried about DNA virus more because it will incorporate into our genome better. But it is all, how we look at it. How what kind of diseases it is causing. So I don't think there is a significant difference between these two. But RNA viruses are becoming HIV, for example. It's all RNA viruses. So they are causing a lot of variations, of course. But I don't think that is the only reason, because the genetic material is an RNA, that is why it is causing more. I don't think so.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, then. Okay, then. Thank you. Once again, thank you, Dr. Anoop, and good night to all of you. All your children have asked very good questions. Keep it up. Join for the next meetings. We have 4 more, no? Okay, interesting topics. Thank you.
Enjoy.